Isn't this armor that protects us from being when it comes to offering is that that's the factor to incoming wives and to brides and brothers. It prevents us from wrong things. And that's why I believe that we fight for each other each and every day. Come together to remember those vows that we made that have caused our hearts to constrict. Jeremiah, this day, when we can no longer hide behind our excuses, when we must admit our mistakes, the ways that we have hurt. Jeremiah, this is the day that we say that we recognize the brokenness of our lives and of our relationships, the brokenness of our world, and consider how to restore this life, this gift that we've been given. Jeremiah, this is the day that we ask important questions of ourselves. It's also a day that we pause and remember loved ones that have lived, whose lives have given light to our lives, and to learn life lessons from them. It is a day when we promise to build on their legacy. Choose to build a legacy of our own. This is it. This is the day. I allow God to be made the most of this day and every day. By living our lives with fullness and forgiveness and love and learning with hope and hope, with purpose and with the promise of tomorrow. Begin with the writing of the
the universe with majestic might, keeping us holiness through sacred obligations, giving us the mixture of divine light and empty blood. By which I cannot have enough of our human life and our land, so I surround you with your mind that is beyond my blood, my heaven. Source of blessing, you cannot have enough. You fill the universe with majestic might, giving us life, upholding the life within us, and giving us to this time.
I told my brother and my president and also the candles to please come forward to the ark as we all rise to take the prayer from the ark, the words of Kol Nidrei.
Oh,
be pure and our promises sincere. But I've spoken words, every vow and every oath, be honest and well-intentioned. But our words cause no pain, do no harm, and never lead to sin, disgust, or fear. And if after all this effort we are unable to fulfill a promise of vow or oath, we be released from its obligation and forgiven for our failure. Let our speech be pure and our promises sincere. Thank you. life. Before I got to this friend, what gives my God is that coming through the prayer and honor to God. Also, be forgiven. The entire community of Israel and the things that you lose in the midst, where all you have done is pray to the Lord. Moses prayed to God, and you have been faithful to this people ever since you did. Jesus forgives the sin of the Lord. In keeping with your God's response, and God responded, as forgives as you have asked.
The image of the Israelites singing meaningful mocha after crossing the sea is an image of power and hope. Energized by the miracle of the waters parting, there is a wilderness of possibilities open before them. In these opening days of the new year, we too hope to be inspired and to see the endless possibilities before us. And give strength right when sickness comes, when death confronts us. It is God's blessing and it's the love that sustains us and upholds us, lightening our burdens, dispelling our worries, restoring our strength, renewing our hope, reviving us. Thank you. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a look at the house. I'm going to take a
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm going to go to the hospital. Kol cultivate those fears of scarcity that have caused home prices to skyrocket, markets to fluctuate, people believe their jobs are unbalanced, and supply chain problems galore. Of course, this year we also experienced so many moments of fear and the years that are out. But as the Delta variant spreads, we are once again focusing on our own needs rather than the needs of the greater whole. It is too easy to revert back to redemption and fear, exhaustion, and depression. We're feeling a deep mistrust and anger towards our neighbors, our government, our civic institutions. Instead of thinking expansively and acting collaboratively, we are still in a mindset which emphasizes zero-sum limitations, where everybody is out for themselves and their own immediate needs. We are digging ourselves deeper into the emotional and social trauma of the pandemic. It's crushing, really, to all of us who thought that we were almost out of this trend. This summer was going to be the summer of liberation. Instead, we have the summer of Delta, a tough Delta. Each decision that we make about masking or not masking, how working at home or at a place of employment or even working at all, sending kids to school or extracurricular activities, attending services in person, or taking a much anticipated trip to see a loved one, feels weighted by the trauma. The pandemic has only confirmed that if we don't take care of ourselves, no one else will. After all, it's hard to trust that others will make decisions that benefit the greater good when nearly 45% of the population in several regions refuse to get vaccinated or whatever. It makes sense that in the midst of the crisis, our natural reaction is to focus on fulfilling our own needs first. But I wonder, I really wonder, what it will take for us to get back to an abundant mindset, to see ourselves as part of a greater whole. What will it take for us to experience a sense of interdependence, even as we're acting independently? I love the Welsh proverb that says, "A key hidden in the heart of the nation is an invisible force." The Torah tells us that when the children of Israel first arrived in the promised land, they were connected to 22 with cost and distance, they were cultivating and harvest the plant, for their abiding came to end as an investment in this return. Tomorrow, Rabbi Hunt will speak about how the Israelites were also commanded to come and to reflect and give thanks, not just for the fruit of their labor, but for the grief that continued to nourish and sustain us well beyond this plant. The Talmud relates a story similar part. It's about an old man who planted a carrot tree. The rabbi would ask him, "How many years will it take for this tree to bear fruit?" And the old man said, "Not for another 7 years." And the rabbi responded, "You know, you're not going to live for another 7 years. Why have you planted a tree when you will never see the fruit of your labor?" I found a world full of carrot trees. Just as my ancestors planted for me, I too am planting for my family. In Judaism, we plant for our hope and the belief of fruitful gardens. The potential of abundance is passed down the door from generation to generation, for our children, for our community, and for our broader society. And each of us, like the old man planting the carrot tree, each of us understands that it is enough for us to harvest all the fruits of our own labor, but rather to plant roots in one of God's gorgeous garden of creation. Roman Catholic author of the Great Ancestor Lifestyle, Joseph Salk, the famous medical researcher who developed the first case polio vaccine, was told the world over. But Salk wasn't interested in fame or fortune. He never planned to happen to the vaccine. Rather, his ambition was to be of some help to humanity and to leave a positive legacy for future generations. No doubt, Salk fulfilled his mission. His legacy will impact future generations for many years to come. The High Holy Days remind us to ask ourselves, are we being good in Jesus? What are the actions that we're taking next? To build a legacy worth leaving for our families, for our community, and for the world. What are the projects and institutions that would help us grow? That will have an impact beyond the outlife. What good values do we model and teach that will give significance to our lives after we're gone? Because we live in an age of pathological sport pervertism. Politicians can barely see beyond the next election or the latest opinion poll or tweet. Businesses are slaves to the next quarterly report. And it's possible that they can wrap up shareholder value. The pandemic has shown us that short-term reason. When we act only for ourselves and make choices that only serve our immediate needs, when we do that, we limit our potential to solve this problem. And we also renovate the social fabric of society. Desperately need a different mindset. Because by acting only for ourselves, we break these interconnected bonds that provide the wisdom, the strength, the resources that we desperately need. If we want to see ourselves through the pandemic, tackle the climate crisis, defeat anti-Semitism or other forms of racism, and build a better tomorrow. This moment, this expansive mindset of realizing that we are stronger together, that we are richer and safer and healthier as individuals and as a community, begins when we consider not only the current greater good of our self-interest, but also the long-term greater good, the health and the well-being of the next. At a time where it's so hard to keep the time beyond our social media pandemic reality, it's all the more important to think about what makes personal choices about the long-term legacy that we really want to create. Yom Kippur asks us to see our place among all that grows and all that lives, and to consider what kind of world where will our descendants come? How will they look back on us? On what we did, or what we didn't do, when we had a choice? What are we really planting for future generations? We are people who will not surrender to fear of scarcity or to stress from the pandemic. That we are part of a great kingdom that is dead and unborn and is that extends us broken through life itself and comes in time. We are the people that take the time to help future generations as hope for our world with a full recognition of where we failed to stand. We talk about this here long enough, we'll repair regularly. But we will not be able to repair the world unless we start with the quality of our inheritance and consider that what values and ideas we live with and choose to plant in a spiritual belief for future generations. do emphasize modesty and holiness, holding on to that thing, but the liberty and resilience is a spiritual part of the nature. How did they lift up distance and optimism, wisdom, faith, and faith? Yom Kippur called out to each of us, what kind of ancestors do we want to become? And to consider the legacy we want to leave personally and collectively. Jonas Salk and the two pages of the poem that is so much more have modeled for us what it means to be a good ancestor. And it really speaks expansively. That is causing the challenge of crisis we think beyond ourselves. It means that we live with our values, even when it's not convenient. Or maybe even provide for funding. It is planting and asking for the future, a future that we will not get the benefit from ourselves. It means that we don't shy away from trust and deep rooted problems just because we don't have an immediate solution. It means that we remember that ultimately we are all on the same team, connected to each other. And to God, if we call the Father, the oneness in the universe. The measure of our souls is not come about through what we have secured for ourselves, or short from included choices of God, but by reaching for eternity through our words and our deeds. Leaving this valuable box in the souls of our neighbors and people that we love. We can be the ancestors that future generations desperately desire. We know that each one of us is an important part of the greater purpose. May our words and our deeds unfold in such a way that generations from now our descendants will say, let us give thanks for our ancestors and the love filled world that they have given us.
In a moment, we will offer the words of Hesitant's poem of Mormon's Comet. And I have some words I'd like to share before that, but I also want to note, because I forgot, every time I introduce Mormon's Comet, there's an extra word in Mormon's Comet from the High Holiday. Let it come, we will let it come. Wherever it can, ever, there's extra. Thank you. Thank you.